sometimes to get ahead in the game, you got to break someone's knee. Just kidding. We're not going to do that here when we're trying to make movies. But sometimes you have to cut a movie about that. And we're going to talk about I, Tonya today on the Fly Filmmaking.
Welcome to Popcorn Talk, featuring movie discussion, news, and interviews. Popcorn Talk. We talk movies.
Hey, everyone. Happy New Year. Welcome back to On the Fly Filmmaking. I'm Marielou Mandl, your host, joined by the editor of I, Tonya, Tatiana Riegel.
Hello.
Welcome to the party.
Thank you very much.
Yeah. Are you a dangerous woman? What is this song? A devil woman? Are you a devil woman? Are we all a little devil woman?
Do I have to answer?
No. Yeah. I think it's better if we don't tell them.
Let's keep it calm.
Let's keep it cool. Yeah. Whatever. You find out if I'm a devil woman. Awesome. Well, thank you so much for joining us. Let everyone know at home where they can find you on social media, and then we'll talk about you and your world.
T.S. Riegel.
T.S. Riegel. And you're on Instagram, Twitter, Facebook?
And Facebook, yeah.
Right on. Yeah, so you can follow Tatiana's career as she continues as an editing badass. You're nominated for an Independent Spirit Award and an ACE Award for editing for this movie.
That's correct, yes.
Right on. And sometimes you're called Tonya, too?
Yes. Tonya is short for Tatiana, but with an A, not an O.
Okay.
That makes a big difference.
Oh, right on. Have you bashed any knees in order to get ahead in your career?
No.
Again, you don't have to tell anyone.
No, but I'm not at the end of my career, so there's still time.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, there's still time. Watch out, because, you know, this movie was really awesome. And if you guys haven't seen it yet, I, Tonya, critically acclaimed, like, this movie is fantastic. One of my favorites of this year. So,
thank you.
And especially looking at as an editor, because I edit also, and I know how hard it is. And I was like,
It was really fun. It was a great challenge and a lot of fun to work on.
Awesome. Cool. Yeah. Well, then before we start talking about I, Tonya specifically, I want to chat with you about your career leading up to this point, and then we'll talk about the nitty-gritty in that movie specifically. So how did you end up in entertainment business?
Well, I grew up in Los Angeles.
Okay.
My father used to teach at UCLA. He's was an astronomer and a physicist.
Oh, my gosh. The smart people.
Yeah, well, he was. and I loved movies. I used to go to Westwood Village and go to all of the movie theaters and spend my weekends there. And this was when they shot a little bit more in L.A., so they were always shooting on the streets. And I'd stop and watch.
Also, isn't that always magical?
It's really
fun. Do you still find it magical when you see a set?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
For about 15 minutes, then it gets a little boring for me.
Right.
Which is why I chose post-production.
Gotcha.
But when I was a kid, I actually used to sneak onto the Fox lot before security.
Oh, my God.
And watch MASH and The Love Boat and all of these crazy shows being filmed.
That's amazing.
And I loved it. I really, really loved it. But as I discovered, unless you're the director of photography or the director, most of the time it's a little, for me, on the dull side.
Yeah.
So I kind of went through this list after I got out of college and crossed off actor, and I didn't want to be a director, at least certainly not right away, and still not.
And why was that?
I don't know. I guess I just couldn't really see myself out there in front of 100 people. I guess I sort of am now, but you know, telling people what to do and stuff. I'm just more of a one-on-one person, and and when I was in high school, I did a little film. I had a little film class and did a film, and I really liked the editing part of it. So that was it. I just kind of went through and crossed off all of these different jobs and ended up with post-production, which I didn't even really know what that was, except for my little experience in high school.
Yeah.
Didn't really know how to do it. And I talked somebody into giving me a job working for free for about 6 months.
That's how you got to do it, guys.
And learned. And this is back in the film days. So, you know, I learned how to sync dailies and mark track and do all this
stuff. And
you were
like physically cutting then.
Physically. Lots of rolling around and lifting stuff. It was a much healthier job back then. Now it's become very sedentary.
Yeah, very snack filled.
Well, it was then too. But yeah, still at least you worked it off.
At least you were moving a little bit. Awesome. And so this opportunity that you got where somebody kind of taught you, this was in school?
No, it was after I got out of college.
Okay.
It was on a small film called River's Edge.
Okay.
With it was Keanu Reeves' first movie.
Ooh. Yeah. Baby Keanu.
Baby Keanu. And and I just got to work for free and learn, and it was terrific.
Great.
Yeah.
And then the person that mentored you, how long had they been doing it?
Yeah, boy. I don't know, not that long. Actually, the person that hired me, the assistant editor that hired me, is now directing. Mm-hmm. Her name is Charlotte Brunstrom.
Nice, yeah. Ladies. Ladies Very. In the film industry. Yeah. I love that. Yeah. And I love that you were taught by a woman then.
Yeah.
Great.
Yeah, she taught me. I mean, I knew nothing when mm-hmm. I started, absolutely nothing. And she was lovely and just, you know, walked me through step by step. And by the end of that freebie job, I actually had a little bit of a skill and started getting paid after that.
Yeah, great. Mm-hmm. And so getting to that that freebie job, mm-hmm. how did that come about? Was it you were like, hey, I want to learn editing? Or you were just, hey, I need to
no,
do some kind
honestly,
of work?
I knew nobody. As I said, my father was an astronomer.
Yeah.
Nobody in the film business at all, except my grandfather, who was also a teacher. He taught journalism. He had a student who became a director and that I had met at some point at my grandparents' house. And he introduced me to his editor, who pawned me off onto his assistant, who, you know, opened up their phone book and gave me a few names. And then a friend of my stepfather's something, I don't know what, also same thing, knew an editor. And I had lunch with him, and he's like, was very nice and gave me a few names, went through the file of facts.
Mm-hmm.
And then I just started calling people.
Yeah, for those kids networking. Who don't know, the file of facts is like where all the numbers were written down.
A paper cell
And you
phone.
Had to like... roll through it to find
exactly
know, just like an address book.
So yeah, exactly. Very slow. So he gave me a bunch of phone numbers, and I just started calling people, and I expanded this list from these two names to, you know, I don't know, dozens and dozens of names in a pretty short amount of time. And this first freebie job was nine generations. I had a chart because this is, you know, this is in the days where I had a I'm dating myself a lot, but I had, you know, it was regular phones, no cell phones or anything like that. So when I would answer the phone, I had to be able to know who was calling me and how I got their number. So I had this great little chart, and I go, oh, yeah, so-and-so gave me your number. Anyway, it was nine generations down of people who knew people who knew people who knew people who knew people.
Right.
Before I found Charlotte, who gave me this first job.
Right. But, like, if you would have done this and stopped at the first, second, or third person and be like, oh, I guess
no,
I can't connect,
yeah,
you wouldn't be where you
no,
are.
No. My parents told me when I got out of college that when you're working freelance, you're either working or you're not working. When you're not working, you have a full-time job looking for work.
Right.
So that's what it was. It was my full-time job looking.
Yeah, that's what I try to explain to freelancers mm-hmm. a lot sometimes, where it's like, your job is looking for jobs.
Absolutely, yeah.
You know, and like, when you have the gig, that's great, but you still need to be planting these seeds.
Always.
And your job is to look for jobs.
And you never know where they're going to come from, either. Mm-hmm. It could be, it's not somebody you meet right now, but, you know, in a year or two or three or five,
mm-hmm.
you cross their path again, and they've got a gig for you.
Yeah, that's great. And then I like that, like, speaking up about what it is you want to learn, like, you know, you expressed the need here, you went after it a little bit, and that's not from going to film school.
No, I didn't go to film school. I was a political science major.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right on.
Yeah.
Awesome. Okay, so you were working on this Keanu Reeves movie, and then mm-hmm. when you started actually making money, what were the next projects that you got?
I got a couple of, you know, apprentice and assistant. I did the regular thing, an apprentice mm-hmm. and then a second assistant and then an assistant editor. I started off on a couple of TV movies and other small lousy features.
Yeah.
And then eventually worked myself up to being a first assistant. I worked on JFK. Mm-hmm. I worked on, I was a visual effects assistant on that. And then I was the first assistant editor on Pulp Fiction.
Nice.
And started working with Sally Menke and Quentin Tarantino for a number of years.
So then what does an assistant editor do versus the main editor?
Very different jobs. The main editor is a much more creative position, working with the director side by side and assembling the footage.
Mm-hmm.
And an assistant editor prepares all of that footage for the editor and also communicates with all the other departments, with the sound, with the set, with the sound people, with the production office, music, et cetera, et cetera. So the assistant editor is sort of managing the cutting room on a day-to-day basis. And the editor is in with the director, putting stuff together.
Nice. Yeah, good. Yeah. And then, like, so the moving up the ranks like that, which we found in a lot of other departments.
Yeah.
You've got the person that does the thing. So there's the editor, there's the production designer, the composer, all of this. And then they've got their assistant, and then they've got their team that builds it. So everything is a department.
Yes.
You know, like, it takes a village. or if you're indie, you do everything.
Yeah, there's a big difference. Like on iTanya, there were just three of us. I had two first, one in Los Angeles during dailies, and then we did all the post-production in New York, so I had another assistant there, because my LA assistant that I work with normally couldn't go, and an apprentice. And so basically one assistant editor at a time, and they did a lot of work. Whereas on other films I've worked on, I've had a team of, 8-10 people, mm-hmm. splitting up all of the same, kind of stuff. Maybe a slightly longer schedule or shorter schedule, but mm-hmm. yeah, it's the indie world, you get thrown into doing a lot of different jobs at once.
Yeah, a little bit different, but still both have the same things apply to them as learn all the different parts, even if you're having to do them all or just your position.
Absolutely.
It's just nice to know.
Yeah.
Awesome. So then what got you into these more major roles where you became the head editor?
Well, at a certain point I loved editing and I knew I always wanted to be an editor. And at a certain point you have to leave. If you want to do that, you leave assisting. And it's a slow process. I worked on a lot of really lousy movies, but just to get experience. I've described it, editing a lot as any, creative or it's like dancing or painting or music. You have to practice. You have to get your 10,000 hours in to become an expert at it. And so I wanted to do that. I would cut anything I could in the beginning. And then after you have a little more experience, you can be a little bit more picky about it and hopefully save up your money in between jobs so you can be a little bit more picky.
Yeah.
And then try to attempt to strategize about your career.
A little bit, right. Hours, but then you start thinking about mm-hmm. what could be possible next steps. But I also saw that you've done music videos, you've done television, you've done feature lengths. Like, so you've cut all different types of things.
Pretty much, yeah.
Yeah, how do you find that those are different?
The one thing I haven't done ever is commercials.
Okay.
And I do really think commercials are very different, or trailers. There's some people who do trailers, commercials, documentaries, reality TV. I haven't really done that much. I think that those are, once you get out of narrative, it becomes very different.
Yes.
And a whole different skill set that I have tremendous admiration mm-hmm. For, and enough knowledge to know that I don't know how to do it, or don't have enough practice doing it.
So what are you editing on? Then
I work now on Avid. I started on film. I worked on Lightworks. I worked on Final Cut. Mm-hmm. But now mostly Avid.
Yeah, because it's the feature length movies kind of have to be for it to be able to process that. Like I edit on Premiere.
Yeah.
And I use I'm editing sizzle reels, so it's like 30-second to 4-minute quick cuts.
Yep.
Here's all the fancy things that mm-hmm. happened at this event or whatever it is.
Yeah.
Totally different than when I look at a feature length movie. I'm like, oh my gosh, could I think?
But
of
they're
how much
features
footage?
Cut on Premiere.
Mm-hmm.
It's just a different tool.
Yeah.
It's like Macs versus PCs.
Right.
It's a different tool, and mm-hmm. you just have to. Once you know how to use the tool, you can
right.
do it.
Yeah, because they always have you're gonna have your cut. You're mm-hmm. gonna have your be able to scrub forward and backwards.
Yeah.
And switch between scenes and mm-hmm. things like that. You just got to find those.
And
I look at it like a video game.
Exactly. Yeah. And the other thing is you have to, when you're working with a larger crew, you need to have the ability for them to talk to each other.
Yeah.
And to be able to pass media around and mm-hmm. and stuff like that. So some programs are better than others, but they're all really good.
Yeah. Well, looking at then a short form thing versus a long form, like a feature. So mm-hmm. I know when I have a 30-second to 4-minute sizzle, mm-hmm. I have all of the footage all at once. I can look at it. It's maybe a few hours of footage to mm-hmm. get that. But for a movie, it's days and weeks of footage. You're taking that piece by piece.
Mm-hmm.
So do you approach that as one small bits at a time?
Yeah. Otherwise you'd be overwhelmed.
Okay. Cause that's kind of what I think.
Yeah.
And I was if I were assigned this, how would I do it? And it would have to be, I would have to still approach it as if they were 30-second to 4-minute segments.
Yeah, you have to take little steps through it.
Mm-hmm.
I start when they start shooting, basically.
Okay.
Sometimes a little before.
Mm-hmm.
On the last film, this Craig Gillespie, who did iTanya, we have worked together now on and off for about 10 years. This mm-hmm. is our fifth feature
right
together. We also did a pilot. TV pilot. On the last feature we worked together, it was a big visual effects action Disney movie. And I started on that for about 4 or 5 weeks before we started shooting, because they do these things called previs or pre-visualization, where there's storyboards and stuff like that to plan the shots. And these big action sequences need to be really thoroughly thought out and planned. Yeah. So I came on a little early to do that and cut those and make sure that we could really have the coverage that we needed. And then, but on most films, like on I, Tonya, I start more or less the day they start shooting. And as the material comes in, I assemble it, and I'm following along behind camera, a day behind camera. And as I finish a scene, I'll send it to the director so he can look at it. They're shooting it all out of order. So as the movie kind of comes together and the holes fill in, you have larger and larger sections of the film, and you get to see this thing kind of being born. It's very different than the script. I mean, the script is a wonderful and amazing blueprint to follow, but with anybody who's made a film, you know that it's very different when it actually comes in and is in a visual form. There are things that are redundant that weren't in the written word. There are things that are very unclear that were very clear in the script. So you always have to, weigh and balance and move scenes around and stuff like that. But so basically that's it. I start assembling stuff, sending it to the director, and then when they finish shooting, I've got everything, and then we just kind of start at the beginning and work our way through.
Yeah, that's wonderful. Yeah. Like, I kind of, like, picture it as, like, a dress. Like, you're building a dress, right? But you want to build a sleeve. Mm-hmm. You build another sleeve. You build, like, the pocket over here.
Exactly, yeah.
But then, like, once you have more of these pieces, you're like, okay, cool. Like, this is how this attaches to the bodice. This is how things work. And but you have this, like, then you can go back from beginning to end and be like, all right, from the top to bottom, like, good, stitch is good, stitch is good, and then go on. That's fascinating.
It's a big puzzle.
Yeah.
And yeah, I like puzzles. It's I've always liked puzzles.
Yeah.
It's a detail oriented and very technical and yet extremely creative. So it kind of works, both sides of the brain.
Yeah.
Very well.
Yeah. And you had mentioned that you had done some visual effects editing as well. So did you do a lot of that on this movie, on I, Tonya?
Yeah, we had a fair number. Yeah.
Yeah.
We did.
Was that like, because I always wonder if that's like a separate team, like you cut it together and then like visual effects comes in afterwards, or you're working in tandem?
Well, we work in tandem generally, just for schedule reasons. And you want to have influence on what happens. You know, they do something and that may change the cut a little bit. So you're always sort of going back and forth. With this, it was a little more specific because our biggest visual effects sequences were the skating sequences. And so we had Margot can skate. She's a great skater, but she's not a professional skater.
Right.
So they had obviously a professional skater doubling and doing the real stuff.
Gotcha.
So there was some head and face replacements. And then the stadiums were also empty.
Oh,
so we put
in
all the crowds and stuff like that.
Awesome. Well, then before we get too far into talking about I, Tonya, let's check out the trailer for it.
Oh, cool.
Before,
so you know what I'm talking about.
You know.
The haters always say, Tonya, tell the truth. There's no such thing as truth. Everyone has their own truth. I was the best figure skater in the world at one point in time.
Call that a clean skate, for Christ's sake?
Do not swear in front of the kids.
I didn't swear, you cunt.
Who's that?
You two fuck yet?
You need to see a wholesome American family.
I don't have a wholesome American family.
You skated like a graceless bull dyke. I was embarrassed for you.
My entire life, I've been told I wouldn't amount to anything. You know what? Maybe I would.
Never could believe the things you do to me.
4.8.
How do I get a fair shot here?
We also judge on presentation.
Suck my dick.
We're gonna need it. Even the playing field. I know a guy. Shouldn't even be saying his name. Derek.
The press wanted me to be the pile of crap. I never did this.
What is
hell's going on?
We're with the FBI.
They know something.
What can you tell us about Tonya Harding?
I don't know a Tony Harding.
Aren't you her bodyguard?
When I was a kid, did you ever love me?
I made you a champion, knowing you'd hate me for it. That's the sacrifice a mother makes.
You cursed me. America, they want someone to love, but they want someone to hate. I mean, come on! What kind of friggin' person bashes in their friend's knee? Who would do that to a friend?
That. What a wonderful movie.
You showed the Red Band trailer.
Oh, yeah. Well, you know, we're allowed to do stuff like that here. And if you guys are just listening on iTunes, we'll make sure to link the trailer in the show notes there. So if you guys are listening on iTunes, please give us 5 stars and subscribe. If you're watching on YouTube, thanks for watching. Give us a thumbs up, comment, like, subscribe, all that fun stuff. So this movie...
Yes.
One of my favorites. And if you guys haven't seen it, please go see it. And I was really surprised by it in general, because I was like, oh, like the story of Tonya Harding. And I'm like, oh, okay, sure. Mm-hmm. And then it just caught me by surprise. And so much was in the editing and the style.
Yeah.
It's super stylistic.
Well, to be honest, I had the exact same feeling when I first heard about it. Craig, like I said, Craig and I have worked together a lot. And when he first called me, he said, oh, I got this script about Tonya Harding. And I was like, really?
Yeah.
Okay. And then I read it, and then I was like, I get it now.
Yes.
Get it. And I knew it was going to be perfect for him. And I think one of the things that's really nice about the film is that it is not what you expect it to be.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you go into the film, no matter how you feel about Tonya Harding or Nancy Kerrigan or any of that sort of stuff, you're going to feel very differently at the end.
Yes.
And that's, you know, unanimous. Everybody agrees with that.
And that was definitely part of the magic of it. And then there's definitely a few scenes in there specifically where, as far as like editing goes, which they showed here in this trailer where she gets like stabbed in the arm.
Yeah.
And that, like, I was holding my breath
for
that scene. And I have to say, like, yes, direction and all of that, but in cutting, like, you have to know to hold.
That's funny that you bring that one up, because that's actually one of my favorite scenes from an editorial perspective, because it, you know, it starts as, first of all, the whole movie offers a lot.
Mm-hmm.
There's a little bit of everything in the film, which is really fun. There's a scene like this, which starts off as a quiet little dialogue scene, a little tension and everything. You know, and then we have the skating sequences, boxing, all of this kind of stuff. So there's all sorts of stuff. But the thing that's nice about this particular scene is that it starts very quietly. It's just the two people talking. And this argument begins. And it just grows and grows and grows. And it gets to the point where they're yelling at each other. And then the mom is picking up everything on the table and throwing out, you know, a loaf of bread, a plate, you know, whatever. And then picks up this knife and throws a knife and it sticks in her arm. And it is nothing that anybody expects, including them.
Yeah.
And from the audience, what I loved watching it in the screenings and stuff was that the audience gasps every time, big gasp. And then there's just like this tension, this unbelievable tension that we hold for as long as possible. And the characters don't know what they're going to do. The audience has no idea what they're going to do. And you just kind of hold it and hold it and hold it and hold it until just before it breaks, basically. And then you allow her to go and, you know, put the knife down. And even then, you know, Lavanna, Allison Janney, is just standing there barely. All you can sort of hear is a little bit of her breathing. And then this incredible tension gets broken by this ridiculously funny line of Allison talking about how every family has problems, which is the understatement of the movie, practically, which I just love this incredible tense moment and then this great release of energy. And you hear the audience laugh, and it's such a relief. And then it allows the audience to move on, and then we just sort of continue to build and do this periodically through the film.
Yeah, and I thought it was done really well in bringing it and like exactly that, giving the audience a moment to feel it, kind of process it, and then release it.
Yeah.
You know, because we have to move on in the story. Like, you can't let this derail everything.
Right.
You know, we have to continue like cheering these people on, whether they're like terrible or amazing. Mm-hmm. so we have to keep going. And like giving this little comedic moment, like the timing for that, it was beautiful.
Thank you. Yeah. It's one of my favorite scenes. I really like it. And it's really fun to sit and watch it with an audience, because every audience pretty much has the same reaction, and every time it's fun.
Yeah. And then so I was also really impressed with the skating scenes. Like, those were like very, very complicated things. Mm-hmm. And so they're presented as one shots. Are they actually one shots?
Well, some are. They're different. There are five big skating sequences. And each one, Craig really wanted them all to have their own personality. Mm-hmm. So, you know, through this process, he designed and choreographed, obviously based on her real choreography, these sequences, but choreographed how he was going to shoot it and stuff. And it was really clear as I was getting dailies that these were all going to have their own personalities. Mm-hmm. And we talked about it and sort of came up with each one. And the very first one in the film is where she's skating to ZZ Top.
Uh-huh.
And it's a point in the movie where she just has attitude. Mm-hmm. I mean, serious attitude.
Because she's still a teen.
Yeah.
Right? Is she in the purple outfit at this point?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And so, you know, she's chewing gum and she's smoking and all of this sort of stuff. And just attitude and aggressive. And he wanted to have it, he shot it in a very aggressive way. And so I cut it in a very quick, fast, aggressive way. And just really showing that anger that she had. And, you know, it's also right after somebody is, you know, this beautiful skater is dancing to or skating to Four Seasons, Vivaldi's Four Seasons, just the contradiction between the two. And then, you know, each skating sequence has its own personality all the way up to the one at the end at Lilyhammer, which is all done in, or what appears to be, one long shot. And that was to, you know, to show... It's obviously at the end of her skating career, but also just to allow the tension again to build. This is a moment where her shoelace breaks and she stops skating, and it's in, you know, the stadium is stomping and everything. And so it's designed to be very different and create a lot of tension.
And I like the progression of that between the like five different skating sequences. If the first one's really, really abrasive because she's young and she's like, it is her. And by the time we get to the end, she's refined, but she's not. But we're like, we're here. We're like, you made it here.
Mm-hmm.
Here we, like.
Yeah, they're all very different. And then there's the one where she actually does the triple axel for the first time, which is, you know, just a really joyous, fun moment in her life. The height of her career success-wise, you know.
Yeah, because you're wanting to showcase the spins. So it gets slowed down.
And just her, you know, her the excitement reaction of doing it. And her, you know. Her, you know, the big fuck you that she has.
Yeah, I did that.
She did it, yeah.
I did that. And then I know that in the movie a few times a lot of the characters, like, break the fourth wall in the narrative, but it wasn't through everything. So was there more of that was shot for the movie that ended up not being used?
I don't think there was much more. I think we used pretty much everything that there was.
Mm-hmm. I liked those moments. I feel like it was used sparingly enough.
Exactly, yeah. You know, it's a tricky thing when an actor turns and talks and does that and breaks a fourth wall and talks to the audience. Mm-hmm. You know, it's a hard thing for the audience to take because you're sort of taken out of it. But it was done very intentionally, and it was shot both ways, and we tried it both ways. There's sort of three parts of narration because the story is all told, is all based on interviews that the writer had with Tonya Harding and with Jeff Galluli. And when he was interviewing them, he discovered that they had nothing in common. They did not have the same, wildly contradictory, as it says in the beginning of the film. And so they shot these interviews, and in the script, it was just all interviews, like, you know, on camera, so shut down to this.
Yeah.
And, you know, because the movie does have a lot of violence in it, from, you know, domestic violence, her mother and her husband. And it's a tough issue, and he wanted to deal with it. And we had conversations he did with Margot and with everybody on the set, and then also with me, about how this is not going to be sugarcoated. It's an important thing to show.
Really in your face.
Yeah, because it informs everything that Tonya Harding did and why she did it, and what becomes her truth through the film. So, anyway, so the point of it, what he wanted to come up with, some way of showing that detachment that he saw in the documentary, that the real Tonya, the 15-year-old Tonya had. And this was a way of doing it. And so, interestingly, it's sort of the 45-year-old Tonya looking back on that situation, which gives you this odd subconscious detachment that she, this a similar detachment that she portrayed or showed in this documentary. So you sort of know somehow that she survived this really violent thing. You know, she gets thrown into a mirror or whatever and turns and talks to the audience. And there's something in there that allows you to know as the audience that she has survived it, but is also sadly and tragically detached from that emotional moment.
Yeah, because it's so normal to her.
Yeah.
And then the way that was portrayed, because that could easily have been like off screen, we know she gets punched, right? Or, you know, like, we see it.
And I think you really need to see it. I mean, we tried and we were very concerned about it. Mm-hmm. And we tried cutting back on some of the violence at times and screened it. And it just wasn't honest for what she was going through.
Mm-hmm.
To really understand why she got to where she did.
Yeah, because you want to be able to see the severity, but like if she's got the line of like, that girl gets hit once and like everybody cries for her, but like for me that's normal.
I know.
I'm just like, whoa, that's a mindset.
And then also by the time you get to the end in the boxing when she says, you know, violence is all I knew.
Mm-hmm.
You know, entertaining and violence is all she knew.
That's all she knew because she.
And that's what she. That's the only thing she could fall back on when she had it all taken away.
Yeah, I thought it was so great. Like, I definitely want to go back and watch it again. Were there any other scenes that stood out to you as favorites?
Oh, there are a lot.
Oh, yeah,
it's. I have to say, this is one of the. I mean, there are a lot of films. Every film I've worked on, I love in some way. They're all your own children, and you have to love them for their faults and all. Some of them are just, you know, you're lucky enough to have a few films every now and then that are just, you can just watch over and over and over again.
Mm-hmm.
And this is definitely one of them. It's definitely one of my favorites. There are a lot. There are a few scenes that we had to take out of the film that are fantastic. That it was hard to take them out.
That's like what is the saying? It's like kill your babies.
Yeah. There
sometimes
are a few.
You have to cut the most beautiful things.
You do, and then you hope they end up on the DVD extras because you want somebody to see them. But
with the way the media is now, it's like those things don't die forever. Where it used to be like
cut a movie
and it's out, and that's all that there is. But now people crave these extra,
and it's really fun. But you know, once you see the scenes, it's nice because I've watched those DVD extras too, and it's like, oh, that's a great scene. Why? And then you kind of think about it, and you're like, oh, I kind of understand why they took it out.
Yeah.
They're terrific scenes, but they stop the emotional. They either stop or stall the emotional arc of what's happening. And that and in a movie, that's what it's always about. It's always about the story and the emotion.
Yeah.
You can't get hung up on a favorite. Otherwise, you're just hurting the movie.
Yeah, you got it. Is what's best for the movie?
Always,
definitely. So I want to go back to the skating scenes a little bit more because we're getting into visual effects and your editing of the skating scenes. So we were talking a little bit before we were taping that like Margot Robbie is a fabulous skater, but that's still a stunt double.
Oh yeah,
yeah,
yeah. Because you have to do that stuff. Obviously, you have to train a lifetime.
Yes, they're lifetime trainers.
Doing other
and
stuff.
Also, like she's like probably insured for so much, like she can't be spinning around on the. On the ice rink,
a little bit
of
both, yeah.
Yeah.
So, I mean, obviously, she skates. She trained for 5 months to do it.
Did she skate before getting this job?
I don't. You know, she. From what I understand, she did not really skate growing up, but she did do. She played a little ice hockey or something.
Okay.
You
so
know,
like she
hobby wise
had been on the rink before.
Yeah.
Yeah, like I had never been on ice skates, so like I've been on roller skates.
And like you.
Yeah.
I couldn't,
I'd go out there and be like, I don't know.
5 months wouldn't help me.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay, cool. So she had a little bit, but we had this person trained.
Yeah, so then it became to design how to transition from one to the other seamlessly. Or as seamlessly as possible to make it all believable, and that was done, you know, really well by the camera crew and by Craig and by the visual effects and just how we and you know how we put it together, just finding those moments, you know, where the camera kind of pans away for a moment and you come back up, or the skating sequences are fast enough all the time that you can kind of get away with a fair amount.
Yeah. Yeah. And that's great. So is that then under your department or visual effects or like where does that land?
Ultimately it's under me.
Yes.
I go through and I decide all of that stuff. And then obviously with Craig, we go through it and we pick and choose and get it to a place where we're happy with it. And then we have the visual effects people come in and start to talk about it. Every now and then there's a situation where there's a shot maybe that they can't do or we can't afford to have them do, or for technically some reason, there's something. So then we have to start to come up with another solution somehow. But fortunately, we didn't have to do that.
Yeah,
that much.
That's good.
Yeah.
Yeah. So like, it always becomes like this moving, living like discussion throughout always, with like everybody.
It's always, it's making a movie is just a constant compromise.
Talk to us more a little bit about just making movies and insight from your career in entertainment.
Well, this compromise thing is really sort of something I think that you learn with time, from as an editor or as a director or in probably in any department. There are certain things where you, I think, when you don't have as much experience, you hold on to things very, very tight because you get attached to them, really emotionally attached to certain things, and you sort of can't see the forest through the trees. And it's really important to always look at that long-term goal in terms of what it is to make a movie. And I think editors go through this a lot with directors, where they feel like they have an answer or know the best way for the scene. And really what my job is to help the director make the movie they want to make. If I want to make a movie, I should go direct a movie.
Right.
So that's what it is. I mean,
like, it is still a support role.
Yeah. And you have to be a good sounding board. But ultimately, my job is to help them do the film that they want to do. And I have to be very honest with them and straightforward and say I don't like something or why I don't like it. And I have to come up with a good argument. I have to come up with that argument at the right time when they're willing to listen to it. That's another thing you learn with time.
Yeah, people skills, we've learned from like everyone in all the departments. Like, people skills are just so important. I guess like to live in the world.
Big thing. Because, you know, you see people, you know, everybody's doing something that's a little scary to do. And they're vulnerable and they're possessive. And everybody's really trying very hard to do something emotional. And it's hard to criticize people in those in those times. So you have to find a nice, gentle way of doing that. But that's my job, is to try to help the director do that. So, you know, there are times early in my career where I was, you know, probably more adamant about something or just, you know, stubborn. And now it's a little bit more like, you know, we'll let it go. We'll try it that way.
Yeah.
And it's always interesting how many times it kind of, you know, It always gets to a better place. Sometimes it wraps back around to what I thought the first time, and sometimes, which is the most ideal situation, is you really build off each other, and it gets better and better and better. It's more than the sum of the two parts.
Yeah,
you know, that happens.
Yeah, like open to the collaboration.
Yeah,
and at any
really,
level that
it's
you're
really
at.
Fun. And with anybody that comes in when we screen a movie, it's really it's great. I mean, you may screen a film and you may get, you know, 20 terrible notes.
Yeah.
And it's brutal, you know, going through them all because it's like, what? And then there's one that's just a gem that nobody thought of. And you're like, oh my God, that's right. Let's do that.
Yeah.
And it's worth struggling through those 20 notes to find that one. Yeah.
Yeah, definitely. Like, I used to, like, earlier in my like editing life, you know, like I would get notes like, so, like the videos that I'm doing, like I'm shooting it and like I'm
everything.
Doing all of it, like all the way to delivery, but it's like for a
That's
client
amazing.
And it's challenging. So then like the notes come in and I'm like, you don't understand, but it's like, no, like I used to push back a little bit more, but now I'm like, cool, let me like let's just see it, like
just
it's not so precious because I've realized I'm at a point where I will continue to create, so it's not like when at the beginning I was like, this is the one thing I get to make. I must make it the most beautiful 30 seconds ever.
And it's fun. It's really fun to be able to be open to that because it keeps the job interesting to me. It's not fun to be in a position where you always know everything. It's much more fun to work with other people and collaborate and to have it be new and exciting and something unexpected happen at work.
And I like the puzzle part. Like I am a puzzle girl. Like Legend of Zelda is my favorite game. Like I just like, give me puzzles all the time. And I think that's where with editing, I get the most joy in like being on set, or, you know, like producing and things like that. It's just like, what's the puzzle of
it? Yeah, yeah, yeah.
That's my favorite part.
It's really fun because you don't know. I mean, you have no idea till it all kind of starts to come together. You know, the other thing that that when you're talking about just this whole puzzle, this popped into my head. It's not really part of your question, but I think it's also a very interesting thing as a film is coming together. And this is something for younger directors as well, but also editors. you don't know what the movie's going to be for a long time. It really has to, you know, it has to kind of percolate, and you have to live with it for a while and discover what it is. And a lot of times, directors and editors are really trying to fit a square peg into a round hole and make it what they wanted it to be rather than what it is.
Right.
And oftentimes what it is and what it becomes, I mean, this, you go through this, but through all of these compromises that we're talking about, when you don't get the actor that you want, or you don't get the location that you want, or you run out of time or whatever, you know, all of those things are sort of this natural way of making the film be what it is, which is not worse than what you intended. It's just different, and different, I think, ultimately always becomes better.
Yeah.
And if you can really embrace that and enjoy that process as it's, you know, percolating up there and finding out what it is, it's really fun. And I think it's another thing with, I've talked about this before with other people, with music with me, particularly in this film. We had a ton of music. And in many films, there's a lot of music. I always try not to put music in for a long time.
Oh, okay.
Which is very different than some people do, particularly now. In the days of film, you couldn't put music in because you only had one track. And
yeah.
So you were limited. But now with Avid and yeah. all these other things, you have so many tracks you can use. And people always want to see things finished, like just polished and visual effects all done. And it really kind of breaks my heart, because I think it, going through the whole creative process, it's important to really go through those stages. And so with music, if you can hold music out of something for a long time, it really forces you to cut a scene in a very disciplined way, where you have to make that scene work without music. If you can make a suspense scene or an action sequence or whatever work without any music, you know, when you put music on it, you're fine. It's going to be better and better. If you put the music on too soon, I think a lot of times you can rely on the music to tell a story, to tell an emotion, to tell a feeling of suspense or whatever that the picture ought to be able to do even
without
by itself. And the other thing that I think that it does is it starts to, people start to put too much music in movies.
Well, and I thought with this movie that there are definitely
There's many times
where it just, the music came out.
Yeah, we pop in and out all the time. This one is a little different than most. I think I'm sort of mostly talking about score right now.
Yeah.
Rather than these scores, as we call it. You know, but you don't know when, you know, if you put music too soon, you don't know if you need it there yet. It's very hard to lose music once you have it in.
Yeah, and I can definitely second that. Even on my little short things, and like I'll start editing to music because like a client's like, I want this song. And I'm like, fine, I'll go in. And then they're like, actually, we don't like it. I'm like, it can't change.
Yeah, yeah.
Because it belongs, like now it's
you work
married.
To that instead of working just with a picture.
Yes.
Yeah, it's an important thing. I think it's interesting. This movie was a little different because it was so... You know, it's just, there's a lot of music in this movie. But
it's like a period piece, and it's a performance, like, about a performer.
It's its own little character in this one. Yeah.
Oh, that's so great. Well, thank you so much for that
information.
That was really, really great. Is there any other advice you have for people who are wanting to get into editing or into filmmaking?
Any other advice?
I want to do editing, right?
Do everything you can. If you know what you're interested in... Mm-hmm. Obviously try to go for that as quickly as possible and find people, you know, find the person who has the job that you, you aspire to and talk to them about how they got there.
Yeah. What's the editor's, guild?
Yeah.
Yeah. What is it?
The Motion Picture Editors Guild.
Guild. Like if you guys look that up, you could probably find some resources.
Yes.
And
they have a lot of mentorship programs through the guild. There's also the American Cinema Editors, which has some internships and mentorship programs. There's film schools that do. People are always making movies on their own, so you just go and volunteer and try to help.
Yeah, definitely. And then if you're trying to teach yourself editing, and like you say, you live somewhere where you don't have the resources to contact somebody who can edit, there's tons of free programs you can use, and like Premiere is like super easy, like super accessible, and you can get the basics there. Yeah. I think iMovie is typically on your computer already.
I think Avid now just recently has a free program as well too.
Yeah, so if you want to get in there, just get your basics, then.
And you have to know. Learn. I mean, now to get work, you really do have to have a certain technical ability to get paid.
Mm-hmm.
But I mean, this sort of show is exactly what it is. You have to go. I mean, YouTube is a fantastic place. Go and watch editors, you know, listen to them being interviewed and what they talk about and how they started, and just try to, you know, do the same thing.
Yeah. Oh, I learned so much from you. Thank you so much, Tatiana. I'm so glad that you joined us.
Thanks for having me.
Where they can find you on social.
T.S. Riegel.
T.S. Riegel. And is there any other, you have any other projects on the horizon, or are you going to go on vacation?
I've been on vacation for a couple months now.
Oh, right on.
And I am about to start a film. I'm leaving for Berlin in a couple weeks.
Nice.
The Girl in the Spider's Web, which is the next dragon tattoo thing.
Oh, my
gosh.
That's so fun.
I hope so.
Oh,
we'll see.
I hope so. I hope it's not, like, really, like, hard to watch.
I'm sure it will be.
It probably will be. But we're definitely going to go watch it. So thank you so much for joining us again. My name is Marielou Mandl, and we will catch you next time on The Fly Filmmaking.
From producers Maria Menounos, Kevin Undergaro, Phil Svitek, and the entire Popcorn Talk Network, we would like to thank you for tuning in. For questions or comments, be sure to visit popcorntalk.com. I'm Sir Richard Wentworth, and this has been a presentation of the Popcorn Talk Network.
The views expressed herein are those of the hosts only, and not necessarily reflect the views of the Popcorn Talk Network or its owners or principals.